Now, this video is about cranial nerve 3, or the oculomotor nerve, and its functions and understanding a little bit about cranial nerve 3 palsy and how it can present differently and the reason for that. So I like to break down cranial nerve 3's functions into three major target areas. Number one, cranial nerve 3 is the major innervator of the extraocular muscles. So as a reminder, this includes superior rectus, inferior rectus, medial rectus, and inferior oblique. Now these are the four that are innervated by cranial nerve 3. And of course there's two more. As a reminder, those are lateral rectus, which is innervated by cranial nerve 6, or LR6 is how I remember that, and superior oblique, which is innervated by cranial nerve 4, and I remember that by thinking SO4. The second function keeps the eyes open. This is done through the muscle levator palpebrae superioris. The third major function is to innervate the pupilloconstrictor muscle, pupillary constriction, as well as to provide the muscles that change the shape of the lens to focus on different objects far and close, which is called accommodation. All right. So now that we've looked at the function of cranial nerve 3, let's have a look at some surface anatomy and the function of the extraocular muscles. So the first thing I'm going to do is label this right and left, as if we're looking at this person and they're in front of us. Okay, now let's label some of the basic components of eye surface anatomy. Sclera, upper eyelid, the iris, and the pupil. Now there's a few other important structures that I want to point out because they're innervated by cranial nerve 3, and they're not actually visible on the surface of the eye, but just underneath it. And the first one is a ring of concentric muscle around the pupil, and it's underneath the color part of the iris, and it's called the pupilloconstrictor muscle, or the sphincter muscle of the iris. And if we just for a moment look at the eye in a sagittal plane, then we can see this muscle here is called the pupilloconstrictor. Other muscle that's important and also innervated by cranial nerve 3 is the ciliary muscle, which is located in the ciliary body and is attached to the lens via the zonule fibers and is responsible for accommodation. Now let's have a look at the extraocular muscles on the right side. Start by looking at all six of the extraocular muscles, and then we'll discuss which ones are innervated by cranial nerve 3. I'm sure many of you have seen this diagram before. It indicates which direction the muscle moves the eye when it contracts. So this is medial rectus, lateral rectus, inferior rectus, superior rectus, superior oblique on the bottom, and inferior oblique at the top. So lateral rectus is innervated by cranial nerve 6, the abducens nerve, because it abducts the eye, and superior oblique, cranial nerve 4, the trochlear nerve. Okay. All right, I'm going to zoom out, get rid of some of this annotation, and in the next part of the video, I want to focus on what happens when you have a problem with cranial nerve 3. And we call that cranial nerve 3 palsy. or as neurologists like to say, they'll say a left third or a right third. So let's bring up an example of a cranial nerve palsy. So this is what you would see on clinical examination. Now the first thing to point out, you're gonna get a droopy eyelid or what we call ptosis. This is from the loss of the action of levator palpebrae superioris, okay? So we get ptosis. Now the next thing you might have noticed is the eye is in a down and out position. Now the reason for this down and out position is that we've lost all the extra ocular muscles except for lateral rectus and superior oblique. Net result of that is going to be down and out. And that's sort of the classic teaching of cranial nerve 3 palsy. Okay? And remember that our other muscles are not working. I'm not going to draw them out, but if we look briefly here, I'm going to note that this is not working. This is not working. This is not working. This is not working, okay? And that's why the loss of muscle tone from these four extraocular muscles of the eye means that the lateral rectus and superior oblique overpower it, and the eye ends up down and out. And finally, you may have noticed one other thing that's happened here, and that's a dilated pupil. And if we were to examine it with a flashlight, we'd also find that it's fixed. So fixed means non-reactive. And that would be to light or accommodation. So those are essentially our three components of cranial nerve palsy. And this would be a complete cranial nerve palsy. And just as a note, the ptosis would actually be complete in a complete cranial nerve 3 palsy, okay? So we'll just have to imagine that in order to examine the rest of the eye, we lifted it because in order to notice the down and out and dilated fixed pupil, we needed to open the eye. Okay. We're actually getting to the point of my video now where I'm trying to give you a deeper understanding of cranial nerve 3, which will help you understand the different presentations of a cranial nerve palsy. So let's bring up another cranial nerve 3 palsy. So this is quite a bit different than the complete palsy we've seen above. This one is a partial, and if this is a complete, this would be a partial. And in fact, this is not normally called a cranial nerve 3 palsy. This is often called a blown pupil, and it can indicate a medical emergency. And oftentimes, emergency physicians will be checking the pupils for this very sign. And this is part of your neurological primary survey. And on the other end of the spectrum, let me bring up yet another cranial nerve palsy. This one is also a partial, and you see here we've got a normal pupil. Assume that it's got normal reactivity to light and accommodation, but unfortunately you've got the elements of ptosis and the down and out gaze from loss of extraocular muscles. So I guess the point of my video is to answer this very question. How is it that you can have a cranial nerve palsy that only affects the pupil and then another one that only affects the extraocular muscles in the levator palpebrae superioris? And in part two of my video, that's what I'm going to answer. And if you're the kind of person that likes to solve a problem or who enjoys riddles, then I suggest you have a think about it before you start part two. And I'll give you a clue. I'm going to give you two bits of information. And the first is that cranial nerve 3 actually has two distinct types of fibers. It's made up of general somatic efferent, or GSE fibers, which are somatic motor fibers, and they innervate striated muscle. So that's going to be our extraocular muscles and our levator palpebrae superioris. All right? And the second type of fiber is actually a general visceral efferent, or GVE, which is part of the autonomic nervous system. And more specifically, these are parasympathetic fibers. And they control the pupilloconstrictor and ciliary muscle. So they would be responsible for pupillary changes. Now, the second bit of information I'm going to give you to try to solve this problem is that the variability in cranial nerve 3 palsy has to do with the structure or the architecture of the nerve itself. So think about how these motor fibers and parasympathetic fibers might be organized in a bundle, and think about what kind of blood supply they may have and how this might affect cranial nerve palsy. All right, I'll leave you with that information, and we'll see you in part 2.